Hello and welcome to Rites Chapel. My name is Tanya and I'm the Director of Connection Ministries. Thank you for worshiping with us today. If you haven't already, we'd like to ask you to type in your name and the name of those worshiping with you in the comments section. If you are watching via Facebook today, we're hoping that you will share our link. And if you are watching via YouTube, we're hoping that you will subscribe. At the end of the service today, we will be having communion, so we hope that you will gather some bread or crackers, some juice or some water for you and for those worshiping with you. As always, if you have questions about Rites Chapel or you'd like to learn more about its ministries, feel free to reach out to me directly at tanya@ritechapel.org. Thanks again for worshiping with us today, and may God bless you as Clay leads us into a song of praise.
Oh, you caught me in my office. All right, well, someone's office. I want to invite you to sing along with us today as loud as you can, wherever you are. If you're in the car, if you're in your living room or your kitchen, you got your kids around you or whoever, sing out loud with these next few songs and join us in celebration.
Welcome to Rites Chapel. It is so good to be in worship with you this day. Whenever it is that you are worshiping with us, we pray that as you seek to draw nearer to God, that you will feel God's presence drawing near to you. My name is Charles. I'm pastor here at Rites Chapel. Again, thank you for making time to be in worship. If you haven't already, we want to invite you to check in. Let us know that you're worshiping with us. You can do so by typing your name and the names of any of those who are with you in the room in the comment section. We also recognize that sometimes it's just easier to text Tanya at 540-604-0038. And we hope that you'll do that. It's really helpful for us to know who it is that is worshiping with us. We also hope that at the end of the service, if this has been meaningful to you, that you'll press the share button, that you'll help us share the gospel with your friends, family, and contacts. And also that if you're ever in the area, that you'll stop in. Maybe that's for a Sunday morning in-person worship or just during the week, that we can meet face-to-face and just have that connection. We'd love to have that face-to-face connection with folks. Many of you know Jeannie Campbell. She used to come to worship here, and then she moved out of the area. Jeannie still worships with us online. It's so good to have her in worship each Sunday with us. Also want to invite you, we will be celebrating the Sacrament of Holy Communion near the end of the service. And so if you haven't already, want to invite you to get your bread, your crackers, wine, grape juice, water available for all those in the room that we can share in this sacrament together. Next Sunday, on the 14th, we will be posting a service online at 9:45 on Facebook and YouTube, but we'll also in person be having just our 9:45 service, and it will be a service through worship. And we will be gathered out front in our front parking lot, bagging up 22,000 pounds of sweet potatoes. And it's called our annual potato drop. If you're in the area, we'd love to have you join us. It's always a great time, a lot of fun, as we work together to serve our community in need. And so 9:45 in person through worship next Sunday, the 14th, in our front parking lot. Love to have you. Love to have you join us. We'll also be in service on the 20th. That's the next Saturday. Travis Nutter from our church, who is also a part of the sheriff's office, is helping us with a road cleanup from our church down to Madison Elementary School. It's on Earth Day, and so there'll be folks all over the county cleaning up our roads, and hope that you'll plan to join us. If you think you can, it starts at 8 a.m. We'd love to have you comment. Let us know that you're planning on coming. It's always good for us to know how many to prepare for. 8 o'clock on the 20th. And then the final thing is that we have a whole new program that is going to be coming to the church on April the 27th. Lola Moore from our church has organized this and worked so hard to get this together. It's called Plants, Pots, and Things, and it's all about plants. And you'll have an opportunity to have some workshops on different kinds of plants and have a chance to repot some plants and learn more about gardening and planting and hope that you'll plan to join us on the 27th. If you have questions or are interested in that, just go ahead and comment in the comment section. We'd love to get you more information about it. And then finally, if you have any prayer requests, we have a team of folks that want to be in prayer and ministry with you. You can type those prayer requests in the comment section, and we want to be in prayer with you. Let us then prepare our hearts as we go to God in prayer.
Hi, my name is Alex, and let us pray. God, we want to believe, but often we doubt. When we awake to the news of horrors of war, hear the stories of people still struggling through depression and addiction, we have to work to find hope as we walk alongside family, friends, or suffering from illness and dealing with the pain of broken relationships. We aren't always confident of your presence. The shadows of gloom obscures our light. We are thankful for the work of your Spirit through the people who encourage us to speak your presence into our lives. They remind us you haven't abandoned us. They remind us that you are present in the suffering. Help us trust God is in doubt. Isn't part of our faith. Help us grow in our faith and build our lives on a sure foundation of us risen Christ. Let our minds and our heart truly take in the good news of your presence among us. We pray in the name of the risen Lord, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is done in heaven. Give us our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine kingdom and power and the glory forever. Amen.
Fitted in. Hi, my name is Brady Mushney. Let's read Luke 24, verse 36 to 48. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Yet for all their joy, they were still disbelieving and wondering. And he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the psalm must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witness of these."
I want to thank everyone who has helped us in leading our worship this day. Let us pray together. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts truly be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Just curious if any of y'all took any Easter pictures over the last couple of weeks. Maybe you took some pictures of your kids or grandkids at Easter egg hunts or a little girl in their new dress, right? New Easter dress. Maybe you have pictures with the Easter bunny. Go ahead and comment if you got pictures. If you got some pictures and you want to post them, we'd love to see your Easter pictures. We'd love for you to just post those in the comment section. I know that lots of folks were taking pictures last week here in our sanctuary as a part of our Easter service. We celebrated the sacrament of baptism with three of our youth, and we had 11 of our youth make a profession of faith and join Wright's Chapel as members on Easter Sunday. It was a wonderful day, wonderful celebration, and yet I also know that to the embarrassment of some of our youth, those are picture-taking moments for parents and grandparents, and some of our youth aren't thrilled to have their picture taken. I'll tell you, having a quality camera on our phone has made picture-taking so easy, so accessible. I was looking at my phone the other day. I've got over 2,600 photos on my phone. And most of the pictures I take are of my family. And yet as many pictures as I've taken and as easy as picture-taking has become, I've never been very good at taking pictures. My family fusses at me all the time. I'll take a picture, and my wife Amy, she's like, well, let me see that before you post that picture on Facebook. And she'll look at the picture, and the picture's never right. I don't have people centered. I'm either too close, I'm too far away. I'm never sure if the light is supposed to be in front or behind. I click at the wrong time. There is a knack to picture taking that obviously I don't have. It was a while ago now, a lady stopped in our office and she said she was driving by the church and thought she'd stop in order just to take a chance. She was a salesperson for church directories. Some of you remember old church directories, right? And take pictures of all the folks in the church. They wanted to know if we had any interest in having a church directory, picture directory done. She, of course, very disappointed when I told her that we weren't. But her visit made me flip through an old directory that I had in my desk drawer from years ago. And honestly, I wasn't particularly happy or unhappy with the company that did our last directory. I'm one of those folks who always thinks that everybody else's picture looks pretty good, but somehow I wasn't ready for the camera. I look funny, I look fat, my smile looks fake. My father tells me they do the best they can with what they got to work with in that. I did notice, however, when I was flipping through that old directory, that in only a few instances were anyone's hands shown. And in none of the pictures do we see anyone's feet. In that old directory, out of a total of 614 hands that could have been shown, there were only 10 pictures of hands and no pictures of feet. And I didn't go through all 2,600 pictures on my phone, but when I quickly scanned, I found I had lots of pictures of smiling faces of family and friends. To be honest, some of them were blurry and they were off center, but I didn't have many pictures of hands and feet. And that was interesting to me in light of our gospel reading this morning, in the way that Jesus chose to identify himself to his friends. It is one of the most peculiar things about Luke's resurrection story. Look at my hands and my feet, Jesus says to his frightened, to his doubtful disciples. There they are, shaking in their sandals. They're wondering if they are having a group hallucination when Jesus offers them for sure proofs that he is who they think he is. Two hands, two feet, 10 fingers, 10 toes, which could belong to no one else but him. It is the wounds that Jesus wants them to see. But isn't that a peculiar way to identify himself? Why not say, listen to my voice, or look at my face? You think you could identify someone by hands and feet alone? Who do you think you could identify by their hands or by their feet? Go ahead and type that in the comment section. I'd be curious who you think you could. I don't know, but I think children are better at this than we adults. Maybe because they're so much more inclined to hold on to a hand than we are. I know I was over at the Subway restaurant a few weeks ago. I was standing in line. Mother with a couple little kids was there, and the little kids were running around. They came back up to the counter. They got back in line, and one little girl, maybe 2 years old, reached up and took my hand. And it startled me at first, but this little girl knew right away that she had the wrong hand. And I don't know, maybe it was the rough skin, maybe it was the thickness of my fingers, maybe it's how cold my hands always are, but she had my hand. She looked up at me with fear in her eye, for this was not the hand she knew. And thankfully, her mother was in line right in front of me before the tears started. And she quickly dropped mine and took hold of her mother's hand. And everything was okay again. At least I thought it was. But I tell you, that child, she just stared at me through her mother's legs as though I was an evil monster. All because I held her hand. And that staring just kind of creeped me out. I mean, think about it. What if the FBI wanted posters had pictures not of faces, but of hands and feet? What if our sheriff's office, when putting something out on social media about looking for a suspect, had pictures of hands and feet instead of faces? They'd put out descriptions. Suspect has webbed toes on both feet. Little toe on left foot appears to have been broken. Hands are square with bitten fingernails. Small scar on right thumb. I mean, hands and feet are simply not the first thing we notice about one another, are they? But they are so telling about who we are. And so I put together a little quiz for us this morning, just to see how well we'll do identifying each other in Wright's Chapel. Maybe the next church directory should be just hands and feet directory. And every now and again, we'll throw in an actual face. But I'm curious, how well will you do in identifying hands and feet of people that you probably know from Wright's Chapel? Go ahead and comment. Put it in the comment section if you think you've got to identify anybody there. I'll tell you, I'm pretty sure I could pick out my children's hands. Especially my older daughter Sophia's at this point, for I have held them so often. My wife Amy, she has long, slender fingers. I always remember my father's hands as having speckles of paint on them. My father was a teacher, worked in school for some 37 years, but every summer during his time off, he would paint houses for a summer job. And my dad's skin gets really brown from the sun, and as much as he would scrub, I would always remember the specks of white paint that would remain on his hands. And I remember my mom always getting after him on Sunday morning because he was going to church with paint on his hands. I don't think I could ever forget my great-grandmother's hands either. Grandma Baker. As long as I knew her, Grandma Baker's hands were riddled with arthritis, deformed and crooked. She stayed pretty much in constant pain. But whenever we would go to see my Grandma Baker, she would always have made homemade bread for us to enjoy. And I can still see those bent, misshapen fingers kneading the dough. I'm quite certain I could identify some of you by your hands as well. I've had the privilege of putting pieces of bread into your cupped hands for over 30 years now. I know some of them by heart, hands that are worn, hands that have some wear and tear on them, hands that have some clue about what this meal that Christ offers us actually cost. What I like about hands is that they do not lie. Hands can't lie. We can usually exercise some control over our faces so that they look the way we want them to look. When I'm upset, I can still put on a smile. When I'm angry and my wife Amy asks me what's wrong, I can shake my head and say, oh, nothing. But our hands, they give us away every time. Nervous hands, clenched hands, clamped hands, soiled hands. Some of you remember the old detective show Monk on TV. Monk is so peculiar, but he notices everything about a person. And so within 5 minutes of meeting the suspect, he tells the bumbling police chief everything about a suspect just from shaking his hand. Look at my hands and my feet, Jesus says. And when they did, they saw everything Jesus had ever been to them. They saw the hands that had broken bread and blessed broiled fish. Hands holding it out to them over and over again. They saw hands that had pressed pads of mud against a blind man's eye, and hands that had taken a dead girl by the hand so that she rose and walked. They saw the hands that danced through the air when he talked. The same hands that reached out and touched a leper without pausing or holding back. And Jesus' feet, the ones that carried him hundreds of miles, taking his good news to all who were starving for it, into the homes of criminals and corrupt bureaucrats, folks who he treated like long-lost kin. His feet taking him into the graveyards where a Gerasene demonic lived like a wild dog among the dead, whom he freed from his devils forever. Looking at those feet, they remembered the vulgar woman who had wet them with her tears and dried them with her hair. They remembered Mary, who had sat there quietly, protected by him, while her sister Martha rallied and railed at her to get her up to go work. Jesus' hands and feet were wounded now, all of them. The hands that had joined him to other people and the feet that had joined him to the earth, they had holes in them, sore, angry-looking bruises that hurt to look at. Only it was important for the disciples to look because they'd never done it before. Earlier, when they had figured out what was actually going to happen to those beloved hands and feet, they fled, hiding themselves away where they could not see the bleeding nor hear the pounding of the hammer. And Jesus said to them afterwards, look, when the danger was past, he says, you can look at them now. And Jesus wanted them to know that he had gone through the danger and not around it. So Jesus told them to look not at his face, to look not into his eyes, but at his hands and feet, which told the truth about what had happened to him, which were the only proof that he was who he said he was. And oh, I know some wish Jesus had come back all cleaned up, but he did not. Jesus left us something to recognize him by. His hands and his feet, just like ours, or almost like ours. We know what Jesus' hands and feet said about him. The question we are meant to ask on this Sunday after Easter is, what do our hands and feet say about us? Where have our hands been? Whom have they touched? How have they served? What have they proclaimed? I look at some of your hands, and I can still see the redness from the splinters of firewood thrown into the trailers. I see the black dots of magic markers from helping a child write their name on their craft. I see hands that have the smell of old clothes sorted and separated. hands with broken fingernails from opening boxes of food to pass out. Hands that have the stains of potatoes sorted, bagged, and carried to the hungry. Our hands and feet, they tell a story. Our hands and feet, they identify us and identify what we live for, and more importantly, who we live for. You are my witnesses. You are my witness of these things Jesus told his disciples before he left them, entrusting the world into their care. So now, today, when the world looks around for the risen Christ, when the world today wants to know what Jesus' life means, it is to us, we who are his followers, that they look to. And here's the truth. They do not look at our pretty faces. And they do not look into our sincere, sympathetic eyes. But they look at our hands and feet. And they wonder, what have we done with them? And where have we gone with them? We are witnesses of these things, hands and feet. We still are the body of Christ. Peace and amen. And again, let me just say thank you for the gifts you give to Life Our Church that just allow us to do so much ministry in the name of Christ. And the potatoes that we will sort and bag and give out, that doesn't happen without the gifts that you give, that you text in, mail, and send in. That just doesn't happen. And so thank you for all that you do, for the offerings that you give, and that you continue to support the work of Wright's Chapel in. That allow us to do so much ministry in our community. Thank you for that. And now then, let us prepare as we receive this holy sacrament. And so if you haven't already, I want to invite you to get your bread, your crackers, your wine, your juice, your water for all those who are gathered in a room. And let us partake of this sacrament together. For we remember the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, and he took the bread and he gave thanks to God and he broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body that is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup. He gave thanks to God and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with each other, one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. With your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, both now and forevermore. Amen. And so I invite you now to share that bread or cracker with one another. And as you share that with one another, to say to each other, "The body of Christ given for you." And then as you share the cup with one another, to say, "The blood of Christ shed for you." And we will take communion by intention, so I invite you to dip the bread into the cup and then partake. And let us pray together. Almighty God, you came in Jesus Christ and you offered your hands and feet in service and in love. Pray that this meal may so strengthen us that we may go forth from this place and offer our hands and feet in love and service to your children. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now receive this benediction, this blessing, and then Clay will lead us into a final song of praise. that we might go forth into this world in peace and be of good courage. Hold fast to what is good and render to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted and support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor every person. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the powers of the Holy Spirit. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts, our minds in Christ Jesus, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear relieved. How precious day that grace appeared, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised. God.